Hello, welcome to Delight Channel. Thanks for joining me once again this week as we continue our conversation on entrepreneurship made simple. A lot of ground has already been covered. I think this would be like number 6 in the series. If you have missed any of the videos, I encourage you to please go back and watch, because this week we are continuing our conversation on entrepreneurship made simple. And it's a very simple question we are starting with, which is, how do you start? If you have decided to pursue entrepreneurship, either because you saw an opportunity you want to exploit, or the circumstances surrounding you is forcing you to travel on that road, how do you start? The first thing you need to do is to be clear about your purpose. Back to the purpose question. Yes, because like I said in one of my very early videos, we were all created for a purpose. If you do not locate your purpose and live within that purpose, success, even if you succeed in achieving anything, is not likely to taste as sweet as it could have been if you are able to stay within your purpose. So, in finding the problem that you want to solve, do your best and ensure that you stay within your purpose, something that connects with your core. And really, just by way of a flashback, how can you know whether you are within purpose? If it is purpose, it is something that you will be willing to do for free, even if nobody is paying you, because it will resonate very strongly with you. And you would have more than enough reasons to keep going when everything around you points towards you giving up. So, if you have located that purpose and you have been able to find a problem big enough for your capacity or your appetite to solve, then the next thing you need to ask yourself is, what do I need? This is called the gap analysis. Remember last week we said, you need to know enough about the problem and know enough about the customer or the people that are going to be the beneficiary of that solution. If you know those two things already, the thing you need to do now that you're about to start is do a gap analysis on the technical know-how. How much do you need? How much do you have? In terms of knowledge, in terms of funds, in terms of links, in terms of connections, in terms of access, what do you need? Be very rigorous, be very thorough in establishing what you need. Then come and have an honest assessment about yourself, meaning what do you have? The gap between what you need and what you have is a very, very important assessment in the beginning, so that if there are critical gaps, now there is rarely anybody who has everything that he or she needs, but certain things are critical, some are optional. If you have gaps in the critical things that you need, then you need to immediately embark on initiatives and efforts that will help you bridge that gap. Do you need to go and study? Do you need to find people that can join you? Do you need to go and join yourself to other people? Do you need to put in certain arrangements, certain relationships, certain structures that will help you along in that journey? It is up to you to make sure that you do not run blindly into that opportunity without bridging that gap. Let me ask you a question. If you do not know the market, you do not know the customer, you do not know the gap, and because of the excitement of the moment, you decided to run into an opportunity, what do you think is likely going to happen to you? You may not come out of that alive. It may completely mess up your reputation, mess up your resources. It is therefore not a light thing to be sure that you have done all these things that we have highlighted and you have taken the necessary compensating efforts to make sure that you are giving yourself a fighting chance to succeed in the voyage you are about to embark upon. Now, The next thing you then need to be aware of are the fundamental regulatory requirements for you to be able to run the venture that you want to run. You need to be familiar with the company registration laws of your country. In Nigeria recently, those laws were updated, and you can now have, as an example, a limited partnership. Right now, and one person by him or herself can start a business. The point is that whatever the law of the land requires, you need to position to fulfill them. You may not necessarily even need to register to start this your venture, but the point is, you cannot do any serious business or have any serious engagement if you do not have a registered outfit. And if you invest money in any form of brand development, and we'll come to that in a bit, without having registered that name first with the company, Corporate Affairs Commission, or whatever name they are called in your clime, you are only wasting money in brand development. Because if you spend money to roll out a brand without being sure it's available for you to register, the point you eventually go to register, if you find that it's not available, all the work done up to that point is not going to yield you maximum result. So you need to immediately start the process of registering your organization. And then in this time and age, there's hardly anything you can do that would not require you to have a web presence. I would always recommend that at the point when you are about to register your business with the Corporate Affairs Commission of your country or any similar organization, quickly do a domain name check to be sure that if the name is registered, you also have a domain name that you are comfortable with that ties the two together, that makes it easy for everybody to recognize your brand digitally or on the net whenever you set up shop there. So you register, and then after you've registered, a few things you need to start doing. You need to come up with like a logo for your organization. All these are part of what you need to start doing immediately in terms of brand development. You need to decide what your logo will be. You need to possibly decide what your font, what font will you be using. You need to decide your colors. You need to decide what will be the vision statement of your organization. You need to decide what are the mission statements or one mission statement. You need to start worrying about the values that will drive your organization. You need to worry about the behaviors that you will require for you to be able to deliver the value. These are things that it is impossible for us to fully debrief in a very short video. But the point is, if you don't take time to define these building blocks for your brand, you are taking a gamble, because there is a high chance you can slowly get derailed. What happens when you do all this? Number one, you will be making investment in a manner that you can appropriate the value. Because if you register the name, register the domain, any investment you make in that brand development will remain yours down the line. Number two, if you do all this and you come across serious customers, when they look at this setup, without having met you, without having said anything to you, they will know that you may not yet be a big organization, but you have the seed of a big organization because you are deliberate about putting all these things together. That's number two. Number three is that even internally, it forces you to think in a clearer manner about what you are about to do. There is no way you can go through the rigor of putting together a good vision statement, good mission statement. You define the values. You can even go to do your value behavior matrix. There's no way you will go through all that process and you will still be the same person when you are done. Even internally, for you as a promoter, the business idea gets clearer and it is easier for you to know clearly what you need and what you don't have and what you must get. The fourth is that when you start bringing in partners or other stakeholders, whether they are investors, whether they are employees, whether they are partners, because this is well defined, you are in a better position to identify who is a fit for what you are trying to do. If, as an example, your business has to rest or reside heavily on integrity, you can't touch anybody who does not exhibit integrity in your organization. How would you come to that kind of knowledge simply because you have done what you need to do to prepare? Now, before I close this week, and I'm sorry I'm getting a bit long-winded, if you are moving from employment, I will be dealing extensively with this next week. But let me drop this to say that all the things we've said so far, they are things that you can start doing by walking the moonlight while you are still employed. One of the mistakes people moving from employment to entrepreneurship make is that they think that, oh, it's about to be a big dive, and then they dive in and everything falls in as soon as they start. It doesn't work like that at all. So next week, we are going to take this conversation a bit further and focus more on, if you are coming from employment, how can you start? And what do you need to do to give yourself less stress, less complications, and a better chance to succeed at what you are going to do? I hope this is making sense to you. I wish I knew this when I was about to start. And it is the body that from my experience, that is making me spend all this time and energy in sharing this with you. Thanks for being here this week, and I hope to see you next week as we continue our conversation on entrepreneurship made simple. I'm sure you know somebody that needs to see this video. Please feel free to share. Join me on Telegram. Drop a message for me on YouTube. And don't forget to make it a date with me. Same time, same station next week. Thanks for being here once again. T-Mark is still my name. And all I'm trying to do is what? Make a little difference. See you next week. Bye.